Well, good morning and welcome to our service here at Nairn Free Church for the 31st of October. Our prayer as always is that God would be with us and that he will bless us, and that whether we're here regularly, whether we're not at all, whether we're here first time, it doesn't matter. Our prayer is that the Lord will speak to us and that we'll hear him speaking to us and be blessed through it. We're going to begin our service singing to his praise. We're going to sing, Be Thou My Vision. O Lord of my heart, not be all else to me, save that thou art. Singing here with the folks at the Together for the Gospel Conference in Louisville, Kentucky. We sing to God's praise.
Still be my vision.
Well, let's turn to God in prayer. Let's pray. Eternal God, we come to you with thanksgiving in our heart because just as the hymn writer that we've just been singing along with, just as he was conscious of God being everything to him, so we pray that we would have that same sense about us, that the Lord is everything to us. We pray that we would be filled with that sense of wonder and that sense of need that calls upon you, asking that you would be with us, that you would change us, that you would transform us, so that instead of being grounded in our own selfish needs, our minds, our vision, our souls are expanded so that Christ becomes our all in all. And we do pray that he would be ever more precious to us. We pray that the more we think about him, the more we consider him, the more all that he has done for us becomes clearer to us. So we pray, gracious God, that you would enable us to be more worshipful and more devout in our commitment to him. We pray that even now as we gather together in worship, whether that's online, whether it's in the flesh together, Lord, we bless you that we have the opportunity to gather with God's people around God's word. We bless you that you've given us this word. We bless you that it is available to us in our own language so readily, so portable, right there in our own homes. Many people throughout the world don't have such a gift. Others only have it online and can't even own their own copy. Blessed Lord, how we thank you for the privileges that we have and pray that they would not make us selfish, but that they would enable us to be unselfish always as we long and pray for the spread of the gospel throughout the world, and how we do long that even into the dark parts of the earth that don't know Jesus, and where there are people in their millions who are still strangers to him, Lord, we pray that you would send your word, send preachers of the word, send witnesses to the truth, send your word online, send it over the airwaves, send it by literature, send it by people, Lord, by whatever means, create that hunger and thirst in the hearts and souls of men and women and children, so that wherever they are, as they seek to know truth, we pray that even perhaps though they don't know it, they're seeking Jesus, Lord, be pleased to reveal yourself to them and to make yourself known in the world. How we bless you for the privileges we have, that you have made yourself known to us. And we ask, help us not to neglect or be careless about such privileges. Help us never to take it for granted. Help us always to keep our focus upon you and to remember that the privileges we are given today can just as easily be withdrawn tomorrow. May we never be complacent about the grace and goodness of God in our lives. Lord, we thank you again as we remember our time in looking at the Lord's Prayer. We thank you that Jesus is the one who teaches us how to pray. And we pray that we would have that sense of prayerfulness about us, that we would have that longing within us to communicate with you, to know you're communicating with us, Lord. The privilege of a relationship with God is beyond the ability of the natural man to fathom or to explain, but you have spoken to us in Jesus Christ, and we pray that for each and every one of us he would be our Saviour and our Lord and our King. We do continue to pray your blessing upon all those in particular need at this time, those that are on our hearts and in our minds, those who are in our prayers, Lord, we pray for them, uphold them, be gracious to them. Those that are housebound, those that are hospitalised, those that are lonely, those that are sad, those that are suffering, those that are bereaved, Lord, whatever stresses and strains have come upon us, Lord, may we find our hope and our help in you. And we thank you that you do promise to draw near to your people as they seek to draw near to you. We do continue to remember our world at this time. We're conscious of the climate conference taking place in Glasgow in coming days. It seems to be on everybody's lips, and all the things that go with it, the disruption and the organisation and all that's involved. But we remember too that our future and the future of our world is not in the hands of men and women, no matter how powerful or how strong or how great or how rich. Lord, we thank you that the earth is the Lord's and everything in it belongs to you. You're the creator and you're the one who has promised that as long as the earth endures, day and night and summer and winter and seed time and harvest will not cease. You're the God who is in control of the micro developments in nature, as well as the massive weather patterns and climate patterns that occur around the world, Lord. They are all at the control of your fingertips, and we bless you indeed for that old song that reminds us he has the whole world in his hands, Lord. That is always true, and help us to be mindful of it now, but at the same time, help us never to be complacent with the creation you have given us, Lord. You have given us stewardship over this earth and over its resources. May we utilize them wisely. May we be very aware of those for whom their very livelihoods, their homes are under threat because of climate conditions. Gracious God, we pray that while we are relatively insulated in this country, there are those who are very much at the mercy of extreme weather. And we do pray that your grace would be poured out upon the nations, not just upon our own nation, and that you would give a sense of wisdom and a sense of responsibility and a sense of accountability to our leaders, recognising this world is not their toy, not their plaything, but they have this tremendous God-given responsibility to steward it well and to rule it wisely. May your grace be poured out, Lord. May we look to you. May we find our hope and our help in Christ alone. May we find the forgiveness of all our sin and peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we ask everything. Amen. Now we're going to read God's word as we find it in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 11, verses 1 to 13. It's actually the same reading we had last week. We looked at the Lord's Prayer part of that reading, and want to look just a wee bit beyond that today. So Luke chapter 11, verses 1 to 13.
Now Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray as John taught his disciples." And he said to them, "When you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation." And he said to them, "Which of you who has a friend will go to him at midnight and say to him, 'Friend, lend me 3 loaves, for a friend of mine has arrived on a journey, and I have nothing to set before him'? And he will answer from within, 'Do not bother me, the door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything.' I tell you, though, he will not get up and give him anything because he is his friend, yet because of his impudence, he will rise and give him whatever he needs. And I tell you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks it will be opened. What father among you, if his son asks for a fish, will instead of a fish give him a serpent? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" Amen.
Well, we turn to look at that passage again, as the Lord will enable us. You'll remember we're going through the life of Jesus, and we've come to this section where his disciples have asked him to teach them about prayer. We saw that they were going back to school. Lord, teach us. And he, the teacher, does that very thing, and he teaches them, as we saw last week, what we've come to know as the Lord's Prayer, with its focus on God as our Father. And he continues that theme because he wants to remind the disciples and wants to remind us that if God be our God, then he is our Father, and he has a father heart for his children, and that ought to reflect in the way that we talk to him, the way we think about him, the way we pray to him. So there's a sense in which last week what we saw was Jesus teaching his disciples what their prayers should be like. That was the class. That's what they learned in that class, what their prayers should be like. And this week it's a wee bit like he's giving them homework to do. And he's saying, okay, I've told you what to do. Now go home and try it. Go and pray. Go and start praying. See what you've learned, put what you've learned into practice, give it a go yourselves, start learning how to pray as I've just been teaching you. And of course we've all got so much to learn about prayer. I think no matter how long we've been a Christian and how long we've been praying, I think that there's probably a sense in which we all still feel we're just learning. I was talking to one of our ladies last week after the service, and she was telling me that she still prays every single day after many years of walking with the Lord, this same prayer: Lord, teach me to pray, teach us to pray. Do we ever outgrow it? I don't think we do, but we're to go and practice it. We're not just to recite the Lord's Prayer and that becomes our little ditty that we trot out from time to time, kind of in a meaningless, senseless kind of way. We're to go into it to learn how to pray. And it's not easy. It's not easy. And so Jesus gives us some further lessons here, beginning at verse 5. There's a little section here from verse 5 to verse 10, where one of the things he teaches us is about persistence in prayer. So we'll have a look at that first. And he illustrates that principle between verses 5 and 8 in particular with the story of three men. There's a man who has a guest arrive at him late at night, and he finds he hasn't got much food to give him. So he goes to his neighbour, to the third party. There's the guest, there's the host, and then there's the neighbour. And he goes to him and says, look, I haven't got any food. And remember, food didn't keep in those days the way it does now. So it's not surprising that this fellow would get caught out, as it were, with somebody arriving unexpectedly late at night. So he goes to his neighbour and says, please give me something. He says, no, I'm in bed and the kids are with me. I don't want to disturb the whole household, sorry. But the fellow who's asking, he keeps on asking because of his impudence. His neighbour will rise and give him whatever he needs. And I guess the lesson here that we're intended to learn, that Jesus is teaching us, is that persistence in prayer, what you might call what this neighbour is doing, is nagging his neighbour until he gets what he wants. And Jesus is using that as an illustration of prayer. And he's encouraging us to be persistent and to be nagging. Pray and ask and pray and ask and keep praying and keep asking until you get what you want. I don't think we'll use that principle for the children's address. The parents will be glad to hear that. I don't think we would tell the kids keep nagging and nagging until you get what you want. That wouldn't do them or us any good. But this is a point of prayer and not specifically a point of what to teach the kids about any more sweets and toys they're wanting. But this is Jesus teaching us about prayer. And he's so aware that we get so easily discouraged in prayer. We do bring our requests to God, as the scripture encourages us to do. We bring our requests to God. And if we don't get what we want, and we don't get it quickly, then we get so discouraged and we think, why isn't God answering my prayers? And, you know, what have I done wrong that God's not answering my prayers? I prayed about this and nothing's happened. I've been praying for 2 minutes and still nothing's happened. I've been praying for hours, I've been praying for days, weeks, months, years it might be, and he's still not answering my prayers. And we get so impatient, but the lesson here is that we're to be persistent. We're to keep on asking. If we're asking a legitimate prayer request, then we're encouraged to keep on asking, because we're not told, I don't know and you don't know, and we're not told how long is proper to keep on praying for something that is, the as it were, the desire of our heart, and yet we still haven't seen it. In fact, there's a verse in Isaiah chapter 62 verse 7 where God himself, talking about himself, is saying that his people should give him no rest until he establishes Jerusalem and makes it a praise in the earth. Give him no rest. That's God's exhortation to his people. Give me no rest. Keep on praying. Don't worry about disturbing me. Don't worry about nagging me. Give me no rest. And yet we know at the same time too that not all prayers will be answered, at least in the sense of what we want. People often say, and you can see the wisdom in this, that God sometimes answers yes, but sometimes he answers no, and sometimes he answers not yet. And I think any of us that have ever spent any time in prayer know what it is to get any of those three answers. We're never promised outright that we can have everything we want. That would be a bit of a free-for-all. And, you know, God doesn't work that way. I often think, or sometimes think at least, of that old Janis Joplin song, "Oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes-Benz?" Well, that's not the spirit of prayer, and she knew that. It's a tongue-in-cheek kind of song. But there are people, and their prayers don't amount to much more than that. This is what I want, Lord. It's almost like writing your Santa list at Christmas time. This is what I want, and out comes this list of things. And whether it's something appropriate or sensible to ask the Lord for seems to go by the wayside sometimes, and people say, "Lord, I want this, please give me this." And we're never promised outright that we can always get what we want. Sometimes our prayers and our requests can be inappropriate, they can be sinful, they can be wrong, they just might be not the right thing to ask for. But I believe that if that is the case, God will make it known to us. He's not playing games with us. And I believe he makes it known to his people. As we meditate further on scripture, we start to realise maybe that wasn't the right thing to ask for. And he's got his own way of making that known to us, so that we end up not asking for something that's inappropriate or wrong. Let me tell you it's a kind of unusual story, I suppose, but it's a true story. It's a story from my own family history. My great-granny was a Margaret Mackenzie. She came from Ness in Lewis and moved over to North Tolster, where all my people come from. And back in 1936, at the time that George V died, his son, Edward VIII, immediately became king by default. When his father died, he became king. But of course, he was the Edward that would end up abdicating before he was even crowned. But at the time, she was a royalist, like people were in those days, faithful to king and country, and took an interest in the affairs of state. And people were excited about the coming coronation and the fact there was a new king. And then it became clear that she wasn't excited, and that didn't sit well with the rest of the family, who would say to her, "Why are you not enthusiastic? Why are you not prayerful? about the new king, and she said, "That man will never sit on the throne." And they said, "What do you mean?" "You know, of course he is. It's just a matter of time until they get the coronation organised. That man will never sit on the throne." And in the end, they asked her, "Why are you saying that?" And she said that she'd been praying for the king, as she always prayed for the king. She'd been praying for this new king, and she felt her soul must have been very sensitive in prayer, her spirit sensitive in prayer, because she felt as though that prayer was wrong somehow, that it was as though God wasn't hearing the prayer, as though it only went as high as the ceiling, and somehow, in whatever sense she felt she spoke to God and related to God, somehow this wasn't getting through, and it troubled her so much. Then in the end, she found herself asking in prayer, "Lord, am I asking for something that's not right?" And he directed her mind to the book of Lamentations, chapter 3 and verse 37. "Who has spoken and it came to pass unless the Lord has commanded it? Who has spoken and it came to pass unless the Lord has commanded it?" In other words, just because we say something doesn't mean it's going to, or doesn't mean it's right, doesn't mean it's going to happen, if it's not something the Lord has decreed will happen. And that verse came to her so strongly that she began to conclude, well, we're all saying this man's going to be king, but maybe, Lord, you're not saying that. And as soon as that thought came to her, she felt this breakthrough again in prayer, as though she'd discovered something important, and she believed genuinely this man will never be king, even though we're all saying it. But if the Lord hasn't said it, then it's not going to happen. And although they thought at the time, well, you're talking nonsense, why are you saying he'll never be king? Of course he will. But it turned out she was right, wasn't it? And he never did. He never was crowned king. And it's just that remarkable sensitivity in prayer, and how the Lord spoke to her in that way through scripture, and applied scripture in such a way that it came to her mind as to what he was teaching her. And you know, what a blessed thing, an amazing thing, to be so spiritually sensitive, to be so in tune with God's word, that type of communication becomes possible. Not, she would never say she'd had a revelation from the Lord, but in some way the scripture was quickened to her and made alive to her, so that she understood that this was the direction that her prayers were in. Because our prayers must always be according to God's will. And even Jesus in Gethsemane prayed in that way, "Lord, if it be your will that this cup pass from me, then let it pass, if it's your will." But, you know, it obviously wasn't. It wasn't God's will, and it didn't pass from him. But Jesus was in a place where, even though in a sense that's what his human soul wanted, what he wanted far more was the will of God to be done. And he knew what was God's answer, and he was given grace to be able to go through with what he knew to be God's will. Or think again of the Apostle Paul, as we read about him in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 8. He was tormented in some way by something that he describes as a thorn in the flesh. We don't know what that was, but it was something that was painful to him, something that was difficult for him. And he tells us that three times he pleaded with the Lord to take this thing away from him, whether it was a physical ailment of some sort, or we just don't know what it was. Three times he asked the Lord to please take it away. But essentially the Lord said no. He says, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in weakness. And Paul had to learn that even though it was something he desperately wanted, the Lord had other purposes, and he was able to resign himself to that situation, knowing that the Lord's mind and the Lord's will were always perfect, far more than his own prayers and what he felt was his need and his want. It wasn't wrong for him to ask, but the Lord made it clear to him that it was not his will to answer this prayer at this time. But we're encouraged to come, and we're encouraged to keep asking and to keep seeking and to keep knocking, because for those that ask, it will be given. For those that seek, you'll find. For those that knock, it will be opened to you. And we're encouraged to come praying until such time as the Lord makes it plain that we're asking amiss or asking for selfish ends or whatever. And he will teach us that as we engage in prayer and in seeking to relate to him. Other times, God's people, and how many times we've heard of this kind of thing over the years, God's people are fervently praying for something, perhaps the conversion of others, the conversion of family, children, grandchildren, and they never see it. And perhaps they die without ever seeing the answer to their prayers. And yet for those who are spared longer, they sometimes see those prayers being answered. The person that was praying them, maybe long gone to their eternal rest, but their prayers are answered in a future time down the road that they never lived to see. But I'm sure in heaven they do become aware of how their prayers have been answered. We simply don't know. At the end of the day, we commit ourselves to God. We commit ourselves to his way, his will. We keep praying as he encourages us to do, because that's the right thing to do. Because he's not playing games with us. He is our Heavenly Father. We are his children if we're trusting in Christ and believing in him for our salvation. And he says a father wouldn't do that. A father, if his son asked for a fish, wouldn't give him a serpent. If his son asked for an egg, he wouldn't give him a scorpion. He said, because he's a father, because he's loving, because he's gracious. He's not doing things like that, things that are kind of mean-spirited. But at the same time, we know that no parent simply gives their children everything that they ever ask for and demand at times. Otherwise, they'd be spoiled rotten. It wouldn't be good for the child to get everything that they want. And that would teach them terrible lessons in life. And if we know that, then how much more wise is God in the way that he distributes the answers to prayers? And that's the point Jesus makes there in verse 13. If you then, you human beings who are evil and sinful, if you know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? He is the best father. He is the wisest father. He is the most gracious, loving, kind, generous father. And he distributes according to his own wisdom and his own love. And he gives his blessings to all those who he seeks to bless. Our prayer requests have to be biblical, have to be in tune with the word of God and with the way that God deals with his people. If we know his word better, then our prayers will be better. There's a verse in Psalm 106 referring to the Israelites in the wilderness and how they complained to God, and they instead of this manna, give us something else to eat. Yeah, and the manna was an incredible gift of God's grace, but they had a wanton craving in the wilderness. And they put God to test in the desert, Psalm 106, verses 14 and 15. And what do we read? He gave them what they asked, but he sent a wasting disease among them. Or as it has it in the King James Version, he gave them the desire of their hearts, but he sent leanness into their soul. They got what they asked for, but it wasn't what they asked for. And it wasn't the blessing they hoped it would be, because they were asking amiss and in their own attitude and spirit altogether. But let me say just this, and we'll bring the first part of the service to a close, and the second part will be shorter. But there's one prayer that will always be answered. There's one prayer that will always be answered, and that's when somebody asks for the Lord's grace, the Lord's mercy, the Lord's salvation. Aren't we assured, whoever comes to me, I will in no wise cast out. There is, for anybody who comes seeking the Lord, seeking his blessing, seeking to be one of his children, seeking to repent of their sins, to turn to him, to know his grace and goodness in your own soul, to know his deliverance, his salvation, the promise is that such a person will never be turned away. That prayer will always be answered. That's the one prayer you can be sure will be answered. And nobody need ever despair and say, I sought the Lord and he never saved me. That will not happen. But it'll be all the worse at the judgment seat when somebody says, but Lord, let me in. He says, you never asked. It wasn't something you wanted. You didn't want it. You didn't come to me asking for it, because if you had, you would have got it. That's the one prayer that he delights to answer, that we're guaranteed he delights to answer as he brings souls into the kingdom. And if you've never asked, then ask. Ask now, because the word tells us, ask, it will be given to you. Seek, you will find. Knock, the door will be opened. The Lord Jesus Christ is there. He is the Saviour. And he is still the Saviour of all who call upon him. Make sure you're not amongst those that never asked and therefore never received. We'll leave it at that for just now. We're going to sing to God's praise. We're going to sing Psalm 63 from the beginning. And it's the psalmist seeking God. Lord, thee, my God, I'll early seek. My soul doth thirst for thee. My flesh longs in a dry, parched land wherein no waters be. We sing here with folks at the Presbyterian Reformed Church in Charlotte, North Carolina, singing to God's praise.
Lord, thee.
Read God's word again. We're going back to Matthew chapter 6, the Sermon on the Mount. Remember, that's the other passage where Jesus teaches us the Lord's Prayer. But he has more lessons there to teach us on prayer as well. And we're going to read from Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 to 18.
Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them, for then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. And when you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces that their fasting may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Amen.
Well, we just very briefly look from Luke 11 to Matthew chapter 6, because there are other lessons there. And I don't want to go into great detail on them, but I do want to mention just some of the principles that Jesus talks about there as we continue to learn from him about prayer in both contexts of the Lord's Prayer, Luke 11 and Matthew 6. And he's reminding us here, for example, in verses 5 and 6, that when we pray, and again notice it's when you pray, not if you pray, but when you pray, that it must never be about trying to appear spiritual, trying to earn human praise or human recognition, human applause, human admiration. There should be nothing that's show-offy or seeking to display ourselves and elevate ourselves about prayer. That's hypocritical stuff. That's almost like playing at prayer. That is not the true spirit of prayer that Jesus is talks about. And likewise, he says when it comes to disciplines, spiritual disciplines like giving to the poor, or giving to the cause of God, or fasting for spiritual benefit, all these things that they have to be about spiritual benefit and spiritual motives, and it's never to be about any kind of spiritual showing off and so on. These things are based on the same principle. You don't do these things in order to receive the adulation, the praise of men. It's all about the relationship with your Father in heaven. Don't start sounding trumpets before you. That's what hypocrites do, so that others will praise them. They stand on the street corners praying so that folk will say, oh, look at that good man there, he's praying. He says, that's not the spirit of prayer at all. The spirit of prayer is when you shut yourself into your cupboard where nobody else can see you, in your own bedroom or whatever. Nobody else can see you. It's just you and God. That's the spirit of prayer. And it's not about being seen by anybody else or being heard by anybody else or being held up as an example by anybody else. None of that matters. Prayer is something between an individual and God, between you and God, between me and God. That's what God is. That's what prayer is. And it has to be that. We're kidding ourselves on if we think that anything less than that is real prayer. We're kidding ourselves on. I'm reminded of I don't even know if you can call him properly a theologian. I think you probably can. Paul Tillich was a well-known philosopher, but what he actually believed, it was kind of dressed up as Christianity. He was asked one time, "Do you pray?" And he said, "No, but I meditate." That's not the same thing at all. Meditating is not engaging with God in prayer. Us engaging with God, him engaging with us. Meditating is just something you think about and you reflect on, but it doesn't in any way become a two-way communication between God and man. I hope before he died, he could change that to say, "Yes, I do pray." Because more pertinently and much more encouragingly, I often think too of the words of the great Robert Murray McShane of Dundee, such a godly man, such a man of prayer. And his wisdom was to say that what a man is on his knees before God, that's what he is and nothing else. Or a woman or a child. What a man is on his knees before God, that's what he is. That's what you are. What is your relationship with God? That is what you are. What is your prayer life like? That's, in a sense, that tells you where you're at. What a man is on his knees before God, that he is, and nothing more. But it's a secret discipline, and it's between ourselves and the Lord. And that's where it's carved out. That's why Jesus says, find a quiet place, find a quiet time where you can cultivate that relationship, where you can be just yourself and God. Obviously, it's different for different people and in different circumstances, at different stages in life. There are people that don't have the luxury of having their own room to go to. Maybe they share a room, maybe they live 10 to a room, you know, and finding a quiet place is just really difficult. Maybe it's only when they go to sleep at night that might be the only peaceful chance they get, perhaps, you know, a few minutes before sleep takes over. But you know, if that's their circumstances, then that's just as valid. It's taking the time and the opportunities. It might be that some young lady is able to spend loads of time in prayer, but then they become a mother and they're rushed off their feet and all kinds of demands at all kinds of times. And they might say, "Oh, my prayer life's gone to pot, you know, ever since this baby was born," but that's okay. And somewhere they'll find the time, and God knows. And you know, these are circumstances. Illness is different. Our working situation, I'm not going to make excuses for anybody. I think you know what I'm saying. Our circumstances can change, but we still want to find time whenever it is there. And sometimes it's little more than flashing a prayer up to God, what we call an arrow prayer, almost like getting a bow and arrow and firing it into heaven. We throw a prayer up and it's little more than a sentence. The desperation of our heart calling out to God in the only moment we've got. We know that Jesus seemed to be in the habit, as far as we can see, of getting up early and going out into the hills. Maybe that's exceptional because of the few times we're told it. Maybe that wasn't his norm, but certainly when he got the opportunity, he wanted to go and spend time alone with his Heavenly Father. And, you know, so much more do we need it. People have always had their special places. It might be a room, it might be a cave, it might be a shed, it might be a barn. It could be the only time they get is when they're in the shower or the toilet and they can lock the door for a few minutes and be by themselves. Just find that space, find that place that works for you. And the Lord knows our situation. But neither is length of prayer the important thing. These people that Jesus is talking to, they love to make lengthy prayers. They think they'll be heard because of their many words. But Jesus says what they're doing, verse 7 here, heaping up empty phrases just to drag it out. And it's meaningless and it's pointless and it's not of the Lord. And he says, you know, to be able to say I prayed for 6 hours or something, you know, might sound great to some people, but somebody that prayed for 6 seconds might have prayed something far more profound and meaningful. Length is not the important thing. Think of the tax collector in Jesus' parable. And all he prayed was, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. That's such a short, simple, direct prayer. But Jesus tells us he went home justified. He went home right with God because he'd prayed from the heart. He'd prayed sincerely. He'd prayed a correct prayer. Augustine says very tellingly, we may pray the most when we say the least. And we may pray the least when we say the most. That's quite a thought, isn't it? We may pray the most when we say the least, and we may pray the least when we say the most. It's not about the number of words. Arrow prayers are good, but if that's all our prayer life ever consists of, there's something not right. Any kind of human relationship involves communication, doesn't it? If you had a husband and wife that never talked to each other, or two friends that never talked to each other, you'd say, well, that's a very odd marriage, it's a very odd friendship. These things are built on communication, and you would worry for a marriage where the husband and wife never spoke to each other. You'd worry for a friendship where the two friends never actually spoke to each other. And we ought to worry about our spiritual relationship with God if we don't take the time to relate to him, praying to him, telling him what we want to say, listening to what he has to say to us as we read his word. It's a relationship, and it's a two-way thing, and it needs time to cultivate it. And if you seek that time, God will give you that time. I'll close just with, you know, some people have asked over the years, you know, give me some tips on how to pray. And you know, the Lord's Prayer, of course, is the greatest tip of all. That's what Jesus taught when he said, teach us how to pray. But we saw something last week of its kind of component parts, the component parts of that prayer. And one of the things I've always found helpful was, must have been taught it in my very young years as a Christian, the word ACTS, A-C-T-S. Use that as a kind of acronym for prayer. Four elements of prayer. A-C-T-S, adoration, praising God for who he is, a confession of our sins, thanksgiving to God for what he's done for us, supplication, meaning the things that we ask of God. And these, in a capsule, are the kind of four main components of prayer. They're the four components of the Lord's Prayer, and they're the four components of most prayers. There's other things that can come into it, but if you're just looking for something to simple and quick, ACTS, ACTS, adoration, confession, thanksgiving, supplication. And I know too, and I'll close with this one, some folk can't bring themselves to pray, and to them it seems like almost like begging, and they're too proud to beg. It's too undignifying to pray. It's too undignifying to metaphorically or literally get on my knees and to ask God for things. You know, I'm a self-made man. I'm a self-made person. I don't need to ask. I'm too proud to beg. But if you're too proud to go to God, then you're too proud, and you'll be lost in your pride. Your pride will damn you at the end of the day. We mustn't be too proud to go to God. We need to be humble before God, and we need to go to God, and we need to adore him, and we need to confess our sins, and we need to acknowledge our sense of thankfulness to him for what he's given us, and we need to ask him to continue to bless us and to give us what he is pleased to give us. And all these things are the things that Jesus teaches when he becomes our teacher. We've gone back to school so that he could be our teacher. He's taught us, and now he's saying, here's your homework. Go home and do it. Go and learn how to practice this. This will make you better. This is how you learn. Take these lessons I'm teaching you, apply them in your life. Make that your homework, and these lessons will start to feed into your life and start to shape the kind of person that you're meant to be as we seek to walk with Christ and relate to him. May he enable us to do our homework well, so that what we've been taught, we learn and we practice to his glory. Let's pray. Eternal Father, how we thank you for everything that the scripture has to teach us about prayer, how to relate to you, that you can be related to. You're not a God who is remote and far off and disinterested in the things of this world. Rather, you encourage us to pray, to bring the smallest of our requests to you, seeking your will, seeking your wisdom, seeking to know your word in order that we might know how you are speaking to us and what you would answer us. Lord, may we never be so proud as to not humble ourselves before you, but to come before you at all times, seeking to walk with you and seeking to live life to the full in the way that only you can bless. Hear our prayers. Take sin away in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing praise, you might not be surprised, is the well-known "What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer." Singing along here with folks at Capitol Hill Baptist Church in Washington, D.C., we sing to God's praise. Brings us again to the end of our service for this week. Join us again as the Lord will enable us. Personally, I'm not here for the next couple of Sundays. Probably Colin Morrison from Elgin will deliver our video messages over the next couple of weeks, and I'm grateful to Colin for doing that. In the meantime, let me remind you to look at the notices as they go by. There's a couple of notices from Women for Mission and fundraising events that they're doing to raise money for missions around the world. So do clock onto that, and the notices that follow the benediction, and all these things, of course, are God willing. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like worship Your holy name. Bless You, time has come. Still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Your holy name. Yes, I will worship Your holy name. worship your holy name. Sing like never. Your holy name, worship your holy name.